Hey everybody, it's Romania Black, and we're on episode 9 of Seraph of the End. Well, yeah, so last episode, I didn't talk about it in the reaction, but I have this thing called the Rule of 8, and usually when you have a series that's 11 to 13 episodes, the 8th episode is usually like the end of the second act leading into the third act, because if you have 12 episodes and you split it into thirds, every 4 episodes is an arc. And so last episode, if we're considering episodes 1 through 12, season 1 or the first core, then we're now moving into the final act. And it seems fitting. It kind of fit last episode. We had the first extermination. Our squad took out some vampires. There were some bonding moments. But it all led them to Shinjuku, where we met Crowley and these other two lady vampires who look like they're going to be obstacles for our squad to get through. And they're headed to Shinjuku, which looks like it's already started a battle with the vampires. Gurren's there, I'm sure. Mika's there, I'm sure. Farron's there, I'm sure. It's just going to be a big old fan-damily reunion, and I'm not ready for it. Because, yeah, Yu finally has his resolve. He's taking out vampires. It's like, what's he going to do when he finds out that Mika's one of them? It's like, ugh, it's going to be awkward and crazy, and I'm not ready for it. And he's going to try to take out Farron, I'm sure, as soon as he sees him. It's like caution to the wind, and Mitsuba's going to be like, didn't we talk about this? And then, because yeah, it does seem like what I like about this series is as we go on, Yu does seem to be growing as a character. Like, it's very subtle. It's very subtle, but like last episode, Mitsuba even noted, she was like, oh, well, see, you retreated, you did, or Shinoa said it, you retreated, you would have never done that in the past, you're thinking about your friends and what needs to be done, and teamwork will eventually come. it's great, but yeah, so I'm very curious. This whole season has been teasing us with Yu and Mika's reunion. It's been teasing us, and of course, I doubt we're going to get it right off the bat. I doubt it. It's probably going to make us wait. There's going to be this big battle, and they're going to be on opposite ends of the battlefield, away from each other, and then it's going to be like the fated meeting, like right at the climax of all of this. Because we have technically 2 cores, or 2 seasons, so this is just the end of, you know, the first half. So of course, I'm sure that it's just going to tease us and then give us a moment of them before the season 1 ends, and then we've got to deal with the ramifications of that and whatever happens in this battle in part 2. That seems most likely. But yeah, I am excited to see. It's all ramping up. This Shinjuku battle seems like it's been ramped up to be the battle of the season. So I'm curious to know what will go down. But I could be wrong. I thought last episode we were going to have this big old extermination and it was going to be the whole episode. No, we did that in like 12 minutes and then we were done. So I don't know. But anyway, I'm pretty excited to see what all happens in this episode. I hope you all are too. But let's not waste any more time. Episode 9, Vampire Attack. Of course. That's what we've been building up for the entire season so far. But let's do that here in 3, 2, 1, and let's go. This episode... We're in the middle of a war zone. Awesome. Man, yeah, this is definitely like, they don't beat around the punch. There's just explosions everywhere. I don't know why, but I find it hilarious that the vampires have the planes and helicopters. There's just something about that. I guess because vampires seem like such fantastical, mythical creatures, that the fact that they have the high-tech technology and our humans have bows and arrows fighting against them, it's very interesting. You would think that the vampires would be more like on the ground and would be more, I don't know, not earthly, but you would think that they wouldn't have the technology. It's a very funny twist to me and I like it a lot. But yeah, we have the black-haired vampire with like the shaved head and the ponytail and the purple-haired vampire, and they're the ones that killed Yoichi's sister. So obviously they're going to come into this. And then we have Crowley. And then we have Farron being a total diva, like with his leg cocked out to the side, giving Mika 9 kinds of hell. And the sad thing is Mika just keeps going back to the same thing from 4 years ago, the same thing over and over again. And Farron just keeps fueling the flames. He's like, oh, your love. Are you going to reunite with your family? Your love, you. And it's like, ugh. I get why y'all ship Mika and you. And I'm sure by the end of this series, by the end of the anime, I'm going to be like, I get it. But it's just like, we're just waiting for it to happen. So I had debated earlier if Mika had actually drank any blood or not, because the girl offers it to him and he's like, nah. But he's not drank any human blood. Interesting. He's only drank Krul's blood. Interesting. Well, she did turn him, so I guess she's taking responsibility for it. But she's also, like, making him her dog. So basically, because, yeah, she's like, I have you in the palm of my hand. If you're just going to drink my blood, then fine. You get to be my dog because you have to have my blood to survive. So you'll do whatever I tell you. Otherwise, I find the world building fascinating. So that also explains why he's aged. Because she says if you drink a human's blood, then you won't ever age. You'll be immortal. You'll be immortal if you drink a human's blood. But he won't do it. So that's why he keeps aging. That's why even though he's a pseudo-vampire, he's staying young because he hasn't drank a human's blood yet. Interesting. Interesting indeed. So I find it curious that there is this... It's interesting that there's this duality here, right? So there's this duality going on. So the Four Horsemen of John, I'm assuming, are basically people that were turned into vampires that didn't drink human, that didn't get enough. If you don't drink blood, then you are going to turn into one of these Four Horsemen of John, basically. That's what it's getting at. Okay, you're going to turn into a demon. Okay. It's interesting, though, there's this duality here. And I'm rewatching the episode and looking at the opening. And the moment that Gurren puts his sword out and, like, the black ribbons come out of it, it immediately cuts to Mika, and I'm like, oh, that should have been foreshadowing that they were going to fight each other. Maybe they won't. Maybe Mika will run away. But that's interesting to note that there's this weird duality where you have the vampires who have to drink blood, I'm assuming from either, it doesn't say from a human, the humans make them immortal, interestingly enough. But if they just drink blood from either a human or a vampire, it keeps them from turning into the demons. So on the one hand, you have the vampires who have to drink the blood to retain their, you can't really call it humanity, but to retain themselves. And then you have on the opposite side, the humans that are forging these contracts with these demons to gain power. There's an interesting dynamic going on here. It's kind of fascinating. So the vampires are just doing this for survival. They're like, well, we either need to drink the blood or we'll turn into these monsters, these mindless monsters, if we don't. And the humans are like, well, in order to fight the monsters, we have to make a contract with these demons. So, it's interesting. But yeah, they're in the middle of this war zone. They just get thrust into this. The battle is just going on. And I like that it's pretty realistic. It's like there's chaos everywhere. Nobody knows what's going on. You and the gang are just trying to, like, shuffle through the madness and figure out what to do. And it's just chaotic. And that's very realistic. I like that a lot about this series. They don't beat around the bush. There's not a, hey, gang, welcome to the battle. It's like, no, they're just thrown right into it. And it's very realistic. I like it. And this is an absolute war. Yeah, absolutely. And Gurren was saying that's what they were walking into. So the vampires in the Kansai region plan to destroy the Imperial Army. Mm-hmm. And I like that they established, so just like the vampires, again, we have all these parallels with the humans and the vampires. Just like the vampires have second grade weapons and first grade weapons, Shinoa says that they have enchanted gears versus cursed gears. So instead of having a demon inside of them, they just kind of imbue their weapon with a little bit of demonic energy, I guess, and it allows them to be stronger than normal. So that's why those arrows, I was like, why is an arrow taking down a chopper and puncturing steel? Because it's enchanted. Okay, fine. I will accept this. But yeah, and then it's just an assault. These vampires, and it's like they clearly have like the lower end vampires being the fodder, just like the soldiers. And then I like that Gurren has his little binoculars. And Gurren is a very seductive character. It's fitting that his voice actor plays Kuro, plays Shigure from Fruits Basket, plays Gojo from Jujutsu Kaisen. There's like a seductive element to those characters, like a sexy element to those characters. And Gurren definitely has that, like when he's spinning around the magnifying glass, the binoculars to look for Farid. And the moment that Farid like instantly looks at him and knows he's there, oh, that was such a good moment. But yeah, so Gurren's like, okay, if we cut the head off the snake, then we'll just destroy the snake, right? How will these vampires react if we cut the head off? So Gurren is being tactical. He is thinking things out. And I like that Gurren and you kind of do seem like mirrors of each other in this. You is not the leader of his squad, right? It's Mitsuba's squad. But you and Gurren have similar attitudes, I feel like, on the battlefield right now. It's interesting. Now, once we throw Mika into the mix, might be a totally different story, right? But yeah, the Moon Demon Company definitely has a reputation because Nagai says, he's like, oh, you're here, then we may have some luck yet. All right. And I feel like the guy's going to die, but I'm amazed he's lived this long. I figured back at the truck he'd be dead, but no. And so then we go back to these bunkers that the vampires just now got to the West Defense Barrier. And there's like just people injured left and right. And here's the thing. The humans, they have all these injuries and they have all these like different places where they're treating them. When the vampires get injured with the cursed gear, they dead. There's not a hospital wing for the vampires. They're just dead, right? So it's interesting. And I love that transition through the barrier. Interesting. So when Nagai sets up the truck for him, the people say, it's ready. Nagai, it's ready. And he's like, I'll take him to the defense line. I'm leaving this place to you all. So what is it? I mean, don't spoil me, but it seems like they're setting up, there's something that is with them they had to take with them. And I guess, is it the doping thing? We're going to talk about that. What the hell? Okay. And so, yeah, all the vampires are just like drinking from the soldiers. They're drinking the blood from the soldiers. Interesting. Which, if they're on the battlefield, unless they packed blood with them, then they would need to replenish so they don't turn into monsters. But yeah. And then old Mika, these vampires with their thigh-high boots. I want to say that Farad was in charge of the costuming. But yeah, Gurren's amazed he can see him from that distance. And then we get, so this is Gurren's squad. We have Sayuri, and she was the teacher. Sayuri, we have her. I like that there's more girls than guys in Gurren's squad. Seems appropriate. So we have Sayuri with him. And then Mito, oh my gosh, I am all about Mito. Has the power, the brass knuckles shooting demonic, like, and it's green. It's like green energy, which again, Gurren has a red sword. What the hell? What the heck? Gurren's sword is red, not green like all the other demonic cursed gear. Interesting. But yeah, but she has like the brass knuckles. I freaking love Mito's design. I love that she has this giant long ass ponytail of bright red hair and just looks like a total boss. I absolutely love her already. It has like the purple eyes, the red hair, the gauntlets. Yeah, I love her already. I know nothing about her except she's badass and I'm all here for it. And she's like, late? What's the big idea ordering me to come here on short notice? Yeah, that hair, how girl, how? But yeah, so there's her. We don't get the name of the girl with the dark hair beside her, though. We don't get her name yet. But she was basically, I guess Gurren sent her to go spy on you and make sure that they made it past the checkpoint. We're headed that way. So Gurren, in his roundabout way, showing he wanted to make sure they were all right. Okay, so we have her. We have Sayuri. We have Mito. We have Gurren. We have the dark hair girl. And then we have this, like, rustic-ass looking man with the goatee and the ponytail, saying the extermination unit isn't handling this at all. And he shows up looking all fly. All right. I like this rugged man that has the cape. And he's like, everyone's here. Shigure. How's you? Okay, Shigure is her name. Okay. So Shigure, Mito, Sayuri, and I don't know the other guy's name. Okay. So we're getting the Gurren's gang is here. All right. Interesting. And then, yeah, Gurren's philosophy. The battlefield is the best way to become stronger if you don't die. Yes. I mean, there's some truth to that. Sure. Okay. And then, yeah, he seems to clearly be the leader in charge of this group. The commander's at the intersection of 5th Street. Something might change if we kill the head. Yeah, I find it curious that Gurren has red on his gear. Like, his gear is all red and his sword is red. He's different than the others. Interesting. All right. And then we get Farad, and Farad's like, oh, look, that guy's watching us. Isn't that funny, Mika? And he's like, shouldn't you be concerned? And Farad is just an ultimate troll. He's just, I can't hate Farad because he's such a diva, and I'm kind of drawn to, like, sassy diva characters, especially when they're antagonists. And he's just, like, trying to be poetic. He's like, isn't it deeply moving that you're back here? And if you can see you, Hyakuya, as an added bonus. And so, yeah, then Mika's watching them all drink blood, and he's getting frustrated because he's got to go off and drink Cruel's blood on his own. And then Farad's like, aren't you going to drink any blood, Mika? So I wonder if Farad knows that he's drinking Cruel's blood. I'm assuming he does, but I don't know. Or maybe he assumes Mika's doing it on his own. I don't know. And then, yeah, we see the guy in the... And Mika looking at the guy in the wagon like he could go over there and do it. Like, oh, there's all these bodies slewn everywhere. So there's so many opportunities for Mika to drink blood, but he won't do it. He's going to just drink the 10 vials that he brought with him. Oh, Mika and our boys resolve. Ugh. And Farad's like, you should drink it while we're at war since you can't drink directly from a human in our city. Yeah, and there's just like puncture wounds, everything. And Mika's like, nope. And that laugh was amazing. Like when Mika was like, ha, yeah, sure, you're one to talk. You broke the law and drank my blood back when you weren't supposed to. And Farad Bathory. And he's like, you hurt my reputation, Mika. What? He's like, you came to me. I wasn't, you know, breaking any rules. You stole my gun and my map. What's fair is fair. What's done is done. And I like that he kind of teases Mika because Mika's still hung up on it. But it's like the defining moment of Mika's life. So of course he is. And I love that Mika's like, my only regret is that I wasn't strong enough to protect my family. Like him and you have the same regrets. They both hate that they weren't strong enough. You hates that he wasn't strong enough to not run away and stay and protect his family. And Mika is regretting that he wasn't strong enough to protect them in the first place. So it's like, both our boys, they're angsty for the same reasons. It's really sad. And he's like, you're self-punishing as always. And then, oh my God, Farad's like, are you going to protect your last family member? You, Hyokuya? He's like, your love? Oh my gosh, that's love. Ugh! Farad. He's like, but Mika, you do need to drink a human's blood. Mm-hmm. You know what happens to vampires, you don't get enough. Yeah, he knows, and that's why he's got Cruel's. So I guess Farad doesn't know that he's drinking Cruel's blood. It's interesting. And yeah, he moves on past all the humans. He fights the fight. Ah! Oh my gosh. Interesting. So I'm curious to know if he ever did drink a human's blood, would he turn into like one of the vampires or would he stay the same? Or would he just be himself, but he'd be stuck in that, you know, because how old are they now? 18? 16 or 18? Would he be stuck in like a 16-year-old's body forever? Is that just it? I don't know. Because Cruel kind of establishes that once you drink the blood of a human, that's how you stay immortal. You don't age that way. That's why she looks so young. And I love that little bat thing that she has. It's freaking cute. It reminds me of the Moki from Hanako-kun, and I think they are precious. So I want a little doll of that bat, that cute little bat thing that's with her. It's really freaking adorable. But yeah, Mika's like, I don't plan on becoming a vampire. Like our boy with his resolve. Oh my gosh. And she just has like the decanter of blood just sitting there. Yeah. And she, I think Cruel, even though she says you're going to be my dog, she's like, you're basically my bitch. Even though she's like that, I think she respects Mika and keeps him around because of his resolve. And because there's all these, like Farad, for example, way back in the first couple episodes, Farad was wanting to drink her blood. And she was like, no, you're not worthy. And I think that all these other vampires want to drink her blood because she's like one of the strongest vampires. And so the fact that Mika actively does not want to drink her blood, I think she respects that. She's like, okay, I can trust you because you're not just in it for me. But then he can't resist anymore. He's like, okay. And she's like, fine, I'll use you. But I do think she respects him and or is somewhat attached to Mika because he's different than all the rest. She's like, you're different and misunderstood. I like you. Mm-hmm. And she says, not growing for thousands of years and getting bored. So she's like, I can see why you don't want to become a vampire. You'd get bored. There's just nothing to do. You just don't ever age. And you stay the same, so it would be boring. That's a smart choice, sure. But you can't die normally anymore. So yeah, she's like, basically, you can't just die like a human anymore because of what I've done. You're either going to turn into a demon, into a monster, or you're going to drink blood and live, or you're going to get killed by one of the humans. Those are your only three options now. Sorry. And poor Mika. She's like, because I've changed you. You'll become an ugly demon without will. Mm-hmm. That's so sad. And poor Mika. He's like, I'm not becoming one of you. And yeah, she gives him the option. She's like, all right, fine. The other option is that you drink my blood. And that's what he ends up doing. Poor Mika. Like, it's so hard for him. And that blood, when it's like dripping on the carpet and he just can't take it anymore. It's just like his survival. And yeah, him grabbing her arm. Mm-hmm. And she seems surprised for a moment. And she's like, oh, you are going to drink it? Then you won't be able to leave me now. Yeah, because she knows. She's like, I got you by the balls, little boy. Because now, if you're going to be dependent upon me, then I can use that. And yeah, and he's crying. Oh my gosh. She's like, forever and ever, you're my dog now, Mikaela Hyakuya. So yeah, that's the thing. That's the big crux of it, the stake in all of this, is that, and her hugging him like, oh, you're my little dog. I'll love you forever and ever. Yeah, that's the stake in all this, because basically Mikaela, he's been drinking her blood for 4 years. He's like so codependent on her. So if he does leave her, what's he gonna do? He doesn't, yeah. Setting up things. Setting up things indeed. And I love that visual of him just like in her lap as she's like letting him drink from her. Interesting. And that explains why he's kind of been protected all these years, because she's like, he's my dog. He's my right-hand man. Nobody harm him. And then, so yeah, so he goes back to this right before it starts raining. He's got five packs there. I'm assuming like he's got one on each side. 10 days worth. Yep. Okay. And I can't believe Gurren. I wonder if Gurren thinks that Mika is the head. I wonder if Gurren went after Mika thinking he was the head and not Farid. So yeah, he's got 10 days to find you in this battlefield. Damn it. He's going to get like down to the last day. And they're just setting all this up. So yeah, then we get to the whole thing with the, we'll be at the defense line 15 minutes. Get prepared. Okay, so they were on their way to the defense line. They were only like a 10-minute drive, maybe 15-10-minute drive when their vehicle got assaulted. So walking-wise, they're probably like 45 minutes, an hour from where the checkpoint is supposed to be. So that makes sense for them to walk there using the subway, but something's up. So this whole thing with the doping... What? This part here was kind of bonkers, because Shino was like, we'll start you guys on your first training. This is sudden, but we're in the middle of a battlefield in the war, so now's the only time we really have to do it. It's a time like this that we have to bring this up. So yeah, okay, so the doping thing. She brings up the idea, she's like, well, we've encountered a noble, and you can clearly see that there's a difference in power. And I was like, okay. So ideally, the ideal way that you would combat this is that you would develop a bond with this demon that's inhabiting your body over a long period of time. And then you'd slowly increase your strength and your bond and connection to the weapon that you're using in the demon. But we don't have time for that. So here's some crack. Like, wait, what? So yeah, you'll be killed in a flash as of now. And the thing about Shinoa, and I like that Mitsuba has her arms crossed and she's got her eyes closed. And she's clearly annoyed by all this, because Shinoa frames it in like a shiny, I totally get now why the voice actor for Shinoa is Shinobu's voice actor in Demon Slayer. I totally get it, because they have the same kind of cadence to their voice. But Shinoa frames it in such like a happy tone. She's like, well, right now you're going to just instantly get killed, but we have a way to help. We're going to speed up. And Mitsuba just says, you won't be of any use to us on the front lines. You'll be worse less than shit dying in the street, lying in the street. And so, yeah, Shinoa says that. And he's like, get on with it. Yeah, Kimizuki's like, what do you want us to do? And Shinoa's like, well, there's nothing that special about it, really. Like, she tries to bring it off as the most nonchalant thing. It's not a big deal. It's simple. It's this packet of pills. And Yoichi's like, huh? It's a state-of-the-art, it's the state-of-the-art training method right now. Basically, it's doping. We're going to have you take this drug. Yeah. It's easier to synchronize with the demon if you take it. So I'm like, what's in that? It is not FDA approved. What is in this? How? Why does it synchronize? Does it make you, like, get super agitated and that's what gets you synchronizing with the demon when you take it? So you can draw out your true power. And they all kind of like, I wish there's a meme of Yoichi's face. Yoichi's like, like, Yoichi looks the most disturbed by all this. Kimizuki is like, huh. And you, all you can say is like, so if I take that, then I can kill the vampire noble, right? It won't be able to kill you so easily, at least. Okay, and then there's this thing. Theoretically, you'll be 1.5 times stronger with one pill and nearly twice as strong with two. And then, of course, Yu goes there. He's like, so if I take like 10 of them, then I'll be... She's like, well, you could basically kill a god. Probably. But after three, your organs explode. Your organs burst in three pills. This is the disturbing part. They've had to find this out somehow. Meaning that they've had a lot of soldiers. She talked back in like episode 3 or 4 about the human experiment going on in the school. So they've had people take these pills to determine how many you could take and when the breaking point is. And they've probably done enough trial runs, enough people have died taking three for them to be like, three's too much. And she said 1.8 pill, or no, she said two pills 1.8 times stronger. So yeah, this sounds shady as hell. Even with two pills, you receive severe damage and you could die of shock. So one is the most you really need to take. Two, don't try it. It may or may not work. So normally we take one and it lasts for 15 minutes. And once the pill wears off, you'll be completely vulnerable. Awesome. So these are for clutch moments only, but... That's so dangerous and shady. What the hell? Like, as soon as they're talking about doping in these pills, I'm like, and yeah, he's like, why didn't you give us this when we first clashed? But it takes 10 seconds to take effect. And so in those 10 seconds, she's like, the vampire probably would have killed you. So that's why. I don't get good vibes from that at all. The more the show goes on, like, the vampire side of it is sketchy with the whole drinking blood. It makes more sense now that that's why they want to stay immortal. And if they don't drink the blood, they turn into a demon. So the interesting thing in all this is it's almost like the vampires don't have a choice. They have to drink blood or they'll turn into a demon. So there's that. But the humans have all the choices. And they're choosing to side with demons and then do this doping thing. So it's funny you have one side of the coin that seemingly doesn't have a choice and are the enemies, are the villains, the antagonists. And then our protagonists have lots of choices, but they are choosing to align themselves with these demonic entities and dope. So interesting. Yeah, I don't get good vibes from this doping. I don't like this. It seems like it's going to cause problems. And so, yeah... Shinoa's like, ideally you need to study and train more to master the cursed power. This is just a temporary fix, but we don't have time for that mastery. So right now, with the war starting and all, we're just gonna have to do this. And she's so excited and happy about it. And they're all just like, huh. Like she frames it in such a positive light, but it seems so clearly fake that they're like, And they're like, well, that's just how life is on the battlefield. That's what Mitsuba says. And Kimizuki's like, keep bringing that up. And she's like, because it's true. And then, yeah, then their tanker gets hit. And so they crash under the subway. And so we've split our gang up. So the gang split up and it's Yu and Shinoa and Nagai on one side. And then it's Mitsuba, Kimizuki, and Yoichi on the other side, which is interesting. Like, who are they going to run into on either side? I'm a little bit worried for Yu and Shinoa because there's only two of them. I don't think Nagai is long for this world. I don't think he's going to make it. They're either going to have to leave him behind or he's just not going to make it. But yeah, they're in the subway and they get him. And so they find him on the other side. And I do like the scene where Kimizuki and Yu both seem happy that everybody's okay. Like they're both smiling from either side of the rubble. And so then Shinoa and them ask, can you guys get out? And they look down and they're like, it seems open. And then Shinoa says, you guys go ahead and we'll stop by somewhere and we'll meet up at the defense line, which isn't technically too far away, right? And then there's this moment here where Yoichi is like, he tries to talk to them, but then Kimizuki leads him away. So I'm curious. I'm curious what he was going to say, and Kimizuki silenced him. So maybe we'll find out next episode. But yeah, so our gang split up, which we've established many times during the show is not ideal because you want to be in groups. So I'm more worried for Shinoa and Yu because they have Nagaya's baggage and he seems like he could easily be a hostage or a chip in all this that is defenseless. So I get worried for that. But then, yeah, we cut to Mika as the rain's starting. And at first, it almost seems like the explosion with the tanker going into the subway is happening right by where Mika is. And maybe it did. But then we see this vampire just getting slaughtered and his arm just collapsing in front of Mika and evaporating. And Mika's like, that could happen to me. I'm curious if it would happen to him. I guess it would because he's a vampire. And then, yeah. And then there's damn Gurren turning around with the sword. And Mika's like, welp, how about this? So yeah, I'm curious to know if Mika's going to run away from him and be like, see ya. Ah! Oh my God. I don't know, y'all. I don't know. I don't know what to think. I don't know what to think. So yeah, there's that. This series just dialed up, just cranked it up a notch with this episode, and now I'm super intrigued because we have world building, we have why Mika is tied with Krul, how he's been, you know, staying alive this whole time. He's been drinking Krul's blood for 4 years. The whole thing of what could happen if you don't drink blood, you turn into like basically the Four Horsemen of John, you turn into a demon. He's trying to get to you. What's he gonna do when he gets to you? He knows that you is here. And then he's a soldier in the demon army. So I'm like, what is Mika going to tell him? Like, yeah, I'm a vampire, kind of, but I'm not drinking any human blood, but this is what's happened to me. So, oh my God. Okay. Okay. This series just got really good. And now I'm really excited for the next episode. This has probably been my favorite episode so far. Oh my gosh. I'm so ready. So I'm very curious to know your thoughts down below. Oh my gosh. But yeah, next episode's episode 10. We only have 3 episodes left of this first core of this battle. I'm sure by episode 12 it's going to conclude. So, or either, it may not. I don't know. So in any case, it may not conclude. It may carry on into the next, this 10-day battle, because technically they've got 10 days. He's got 10 days to find you. So it may not conclude this season. It may carry on for the rest of the entire season. I don't know. I don't want to be spoiled. I like going in blind, but oh y'all. So in any case, I'm excited to know your thoughts down below, but I hope y'all have a wonderful week. Please stay safe, take care, and oh my gosh, yes, we're going to be back very soon with more Seraph of the End. Bye.